thank you for the invitation to come back here. It's wonderful to be here. I think this is a fantastic program that you run here, and it's been especially a privilege to be nice to meet with Andy and Helen in the place where Cornet, my publisher, are doing so much to kind of keep the poetry torch burning. This poem, Italy to Lord, I don't know if I had written this by the time I read here last. Italy to Lord is the categorisation of one of the 16 volumes of the Encyclopaedia Britannica. The 16 volumes that I grew up with as a child in a kind of glass-fronted bookcase that my mother had also grown up with. And I still can't give them away. They're pretty extraordinary. The 1922 edition is sort of printed on Bible paper, which gives it a strange authority. But some of the material in there, some of the physics entries were written by Einstein. There's a lot in there that's very interesting. Italy to Lord. It's dark in here, and forest green, Britannica. 16 oak trees in a London living room. The little girl, my mother, in the bookcase glass. Italy, Ithaca, Ishmael, Japan. Each page a mainsail turning. HMS Discovery. None of the rivers of southern Italy are of any great importance. Like birds on long-haul flight, let not seas or deserts, cliffs or icy mountain tops impede you. Jews, Kabir, Kabul, Kafir. From up here, all seems clear. All evil in the world's ascribed to Maya or illusion. Then home at last, returned from all those navigable miles to liking, limit, logic, London. To find a century has passed, the forests cleared, the animals all bared and scorched, the gold all brought to light. I look into the glass, discover there myself in dense shade, deep and shadowy as on any wooded island. I'm sure many of you are familiar with Shakespeare's extraordinary play, The Winter's Tale, where a great deal happens in a very short time at the beginning of the play, and you wonder how can we sustain this for four more acts. So Hermione, the Queen, is accused wrongly of adultery by her husband, the King, has her children taken away from her, her boy dies of sorrow as she is banished, her new baby is taken from her to be taken to the forest. She's unjustly accused within, I don't know, something like 15 minutes at the beginning of the play. The worst possible things that could have happened have happened. And when she is defending her innocence before the king, she says, "The Emperor of Russia was my father," as if to say, if he could see this, lost. Sleep is a Russian winter where you are a girl again and turned to stone, lost, so it seems, like everything. Only your foundling heart still stirs. Better, perhaps, to have been born a tree, to live on summer after summer, leaves and branches shifting like a child's hair lifted in the wind. The wonder is, the waking world is so much like the dream. All's pale, the like silence, though across the sheet of snow you almost hear them call. Astonish us, they seem to say. Astonish us again today. This poem, Prospect, imagines that even with all the advances in medical technology, not everyone necessarily might want to live forever. Prospect. Anyone who wanted to could leave, could gather, shivering, on the south side of the river, labelled and provided for with socks and sweaters and a little cash. We walked across the water in our thousands and left behind forever all that was great. The monuments and sewers, cathedrals, theatres, mothers, lovers, brothers, as the flames licked at the city's raging heart. Faced with the prospect of living forever, we headed for the country lanes together, imagining the party to confine among the clover and the stories each would tell the others on the way. We had left behind forever all that we had loved. It was a start. I was asked, I was honoured to be asked by the British Film Institute to take part in their celebration of Pasolini's films, ten of Pasolini's films, in a new poetic Decameron. And I was asked to write about Medea. So I don't know if you know Medea, and I don't know if you know Pasolini's work. If you can imagine putting them together, that's what this is. It's a fantastic film, actually. Callas is Medea. Maria Callas is Medea in this film, who, famous then, at the time the film was made, for her wonderful voice. I mean, she's at the peak of her career, and she doesn't say anything, or practically nothing, in the whole film. It's a superb film, crazy film. Each day, there's a song I used to know. I used to jump out of bed in the morning singing it like a new recruit ready for the day. It sounded like an old song from Europe, where the air is so dry and the grass glittering with the husks of tiny snails. It was a song about silence, a silence so profound you could hear cars in it and trains and crowds chanting as they moved like one alive beast slithering down the boulevards, and whoop, it went, and anyone. All day long, I'd have that song in my head, peeling potatoes, putting the children to bed, because singing is good for you, in the same way as birdsong. Singing your heart out from up on the battlements, opening your mouth like a cave on an arid hillside, the loudest song you could sing. And now I've taught it to my children. Otherwise, each day would be like the Marie Celeste, as if someone had cast a spell on it. If any of you are fasting right now, or otherwise depriving yourself of things that you'd really like to indulge in these 40 days, this is for you. Lent. The bailiff winds are at the door. Alcohol and cigarettes must go. Abstain, repent. No meat, no chocolate, no more obsessive checking of your phone like the pulse of a dying friend. Refrain. No more taking photographs of pictures. Let the world go, like Michelangelo's sculpture, made of snow, that no one framed. The house lies purged and empty. Still the winds blow. Now give up the wilderness, the wandering. Retreat instead to that windless winter morning when a young man stood in the gardens of the palazzo, lips glistening, hair shining at the nape before the bomb blast of sun, not anyone's to keep. It's wonderful to actually read in an art gallery. I can't think of a better place for poetry readings actually to take place. So this is a poem. This is a poem in homage to all galleries and all museums. It's called Lollhead Lettuce. Don't look for that in Tesco because you won't find it. I don't know where the name came from. Lollhead Lettuce. So, was that gardener someone's father who, flying through the doors of the National Gallery, the wind at his back, shorn blossoms at his heels, raced down the long halls of nations, transfigurations, and transmigrations of the soul to cut a clean path to the flowers and the fruit, the insect life and shells, only to stand there, grafting life in hand, so rapt and still. And in his nature rapture, how was that act so private by which he took the fresh green head, the dew still perfect in its eye, lifting it from the canvas like a child from a cot, out from among the wine and snuffed out candles, the ticking watch and half-devoured pies, so quietly as not to wake it, and nothing in the scene protesting as he walked away. As he carried it to his garden, sweet lolling head, heart white with traces of the milky, sleep-inducing ooze, to give it life, another life. I like to think that father gardener was mine. Inside you lies a second human heart that's dreaming of a house that could be built. A tiny staircase, two small fireplaces, a painted door and trompe l'oeil balcony, a miniature roof light open to the sky. Outside the doors, an orchard lit with fruit which scattered on the ground spell welcome, eat. Sparked by love, your extra bird heart flies inside a month or two, no more. Still vestiges of the house remain. Some tiles, the outline of a formal garden, traces of a small face at a window, eyes, an arm and fingers clearly visible. Details it will be a life's work to restore. Um, Helen, you had at least two poems, with the moon at the beginning. There were probably more. and so this is probably a rather feeble response, but anyway, this is a poem called The Stare. It's that idea that somehow we're looking up at the moon. When there's a full moon, it's just staring back at us. The Stare. Outside our block of flats, the moon has planted itself like a searchlight, flooding in through our Indian curtains and neat Japanese-style blinds, onto the film sets of all our stacked-up living rooms. Caught in some small act, we are drowned in its platinum stare. My own room glows, its forest of furniture, the deep ocean blue of my carpet. Not looking, just letting us know it's there. After all, life must go on. Soon, it won't just be hanging around out there. It'll climb right in and carry this body of mine out into the freezing air, past the suburbs, the Ministry of Global Affairs, up to the region of gathering winds. It'll be like a giant's delicate hand. It'll be like a winged horse ride. It'll be like a police searchlight. I'm just going to read one more poem. This is for those of you who have ever Googled their own name. So, the idea of this came sitting on a train. It happens everywhere now. The world is passing, we're all looking at art. We're all Googling some of our namesake. We ride this train together. The laundered fields, the grass, hoar-frosted like a baker's boy, stepped out at dawn. Inside, we hold our silent winter party, scan the multiverse, and all our doppelgangers there. Can it be that I am also a firefighter in Texas? That I have entered blazing warehouses, cut drivers from their burning cars, searched in the rubble for signs of the living when all around lay dead or counted lost? I see your pale face passing in a field of frost, and like old Priam, wonder, ah, did my son exist? Was he a dream? The rails hand us down the line. I do not know who it is that is travelling on this train. Boy, in a field, you watch me pass, but do not wave. Could it be, if I chose, I could be fearless, could be brave?